Bienvenidos a todos y todas a un nuevo seminario de investigaciones económicas. Hoy tenemos el agrado de presentar a Sebastián Dullien en su artículo Crisis de deuda y la pandemia, cómo Europa evitó repetir la crisis de la eurozona de 2010-2012 durante el COVID-19. Sebastián es director del Instituto de Política Macroeconómica en Düsseldorf y profesor de Economía Internacional en la Facultad de Ciencias Aplicadas de la Universidad de Tecnología y Economía de Berlín. También trabajó para la UNCTAD, hizo trabajos de consultoría para la CEPAL y dirigió un programa de cooperación universitaria que incluyó la participación de la UBA. Posee un doctorado en Economía de la Freie Universität de Berlín y se ha especializado en temas relacionados con la política monetaria, la macroeconomía, el estudio de regímenes cambiarios y de integración monetaria en la Unión Europea. Sus papers más recientes se vinculan con el estudio de las crisis financieras y las políticas necesarias para combatir sus consecuencias. Sus trabajos han sido publicados en diversos journals internacionales. So, Sebastián, when you want, the time is yours.
Well, thank you very much first. Well, thank you very much for the nice introduction and thanks for the invitation. Of course, it would be nicer to be with you to present in Buenos Aires, but this is second best and I'm very happy because as I said before, Argentina has always been one of my favorite countries in Latin America, not just for the food and the people, but also because if you're interested in economic crisis, it is a good place to do research. And frankly, I have learned, I used to be an economic journalist for the Financial Times Deutschland, the German language edition, which we had at some time in the past of the Financial Times. And I covered the Argentinian crisis of 2001, 2002 as a journalist, basically. And I learned a lot about, which helped me later to understand the euro crisis. And actually, so that is, I have personal connections to Argentina. I have been asked today to talk about or to present something about that crisis and the pandemic in Europe. And basically, I mean, what I'm doing here is based on a number of papers we have written in the past couple of years. There's not yet a coherent paper which puts all of that together, but I hope my presentation will be reasonably coherent. I'm going to ask the question, why haven't we seen a replay of the euro area debt crisis this time round? Because I mean, I'll show you some macroeconomic indicators and you will see that by all indicators possible, the situation today looks worse than 10 years ago, yet we prevented a replay of that debt crisis. And I mean, maybe you haven't all followed that debt crisis 10 years ago, but it was quite, for us, it was quite existential. We had a number of countries which were in a prolonged crisis. We had Greece, which had to default. Greece still hasn't recovered from that crisis. The GDP per capita is still significantly by double digits below what they had prior to the crisis. And this crisis spread to Italy, to Spain, to Portugal, to Ireland. And at the height of the crisis, we were all afraid of the Eurozone breaking apart, which probably would have trashed not only the banking systems in the south of the euro area, but also the German banking system. I think it's a quite interesting topic why this has not replayed. I'll start showing you macroeconomic conditions today versus roughly 10 years ago. Then I'm going to take a step back and look at the origins of the crisis of 2010-2012. And my hypothesis is that there are two main or three reasons basically why this crisis has not replayed. The first is we are in a different macroeconomic environment globally, but the two others are basically policy reactions. First, there have been some institutional reforms since 2010 in the euro area, which have basically cut some of the roots of the past crisis. And second, policymakers reacted much more decisively and very differently from 10 years ago. So let me start with some graphs. What you see here are government deficits 2010 and 2020. And well, the light bar there is Greece, for which the crisis started in 2010. But I also brought you the deficits for Spain, Italy, France, countries where the crisis spread later. And if you look at that, I mean, except for Greece, which admittedly had higher deficits at that time, the deficits now are at least as large as they were 10 years ago. Also, if you look at debt to GDP ratios, which we see here, you see the situation is much worse today than it was 10 years ago. I mean, 10 years ago, you had countries like Spain, who later went into a crisis, which had debt to GDP ratios of only 40% or so. Now you might say from an Argentinian perspective or from an emerging market perspective, 40% is already not that low. But well, I mean, first, for the Euro context, for Germany, comparable to Germany, it was low at that point. Plus, if you look at this graph, you see that debt to GDP ratios are much, much higher today. So, I mean, Spain and France, they entered the COVID crisis with debt to GDP ratios of roughly 100%. Italy was at something like 130. I mean, you have still Greece here, which has a debt to GDP ratio of almost 200. So really, the debt situation is much worse than it was 10 years ago. Yet, bond spreads did not move. What you see here on the right-hand side is government bond spreads in percentage points relative to German bonds. That's how we show them in the euro area, because German bonds are seen as the safe asset for the euro area. You don't have any, and if you compare, you don't have any exchange rate risk, except you think about a country leaving the euro, then you have the denomination risk here. But besides that, that's the comparison. And if I would look at the levels of interest rates, the picture would even be a bit starker, because European interest rates have been negative for a wide range of maturities for quite a while now. And actually, we have a number of European countries which also had negative interest rates. So in this crisis, despite this increase in deficits, the high debt levels, and I haven't shown that to you, but we all the countries experienced a large drop in GDP in 2020. Despite this situation, the spreads have not moved much. And so if you can compare here, I mean, of course, this spike is Greece, and that was just basically around the default, 3,500 basis points. That's basically, I think that's a bit comparable to what Argentina experienced in the early 2000s. But I mean, even if you look at Portugal or Spain, these are, and these countries all had low inflation rates. So 500 basis points, 1,000 basis points, that is quite significant, especially if you have government debt to GDP ratios, which even at that time were 60 to 100%. And if you compare that to here, there was very little movement. And here I pulled this a bit apart, so you see this picture better. On the left-hand side, it's 2010 or 9, 10, 11, 12. And on the right-hand side, this is the COVID crisis. And well, yeah, you see this is really, I mean, it's a minor movement there. And the question is, what is the reason for that? Okay. And of course, this has some consequences. At least if we look at the current forecasts, we expect, and this is the European Commission forecast, so it's not our optimism, but we expect that the countries will recover much more quickly. So there, all of the countries, most of them will reach pre-pandemic GDP levels in 2022. Spain will take a bit longer, and the reason is that Spain has a quite large tourism sector, and at the moment we have very little cross-border tourism, or we have very limited cross-border tourism in Europe. But if you compare that again to the crisis of 2009-10, you see at that time it took much, much longer for the countries to regain the output lost. And the orange line here is Greece. And you see they are still at a level of about 75% of 2007 or 2008 output. And again, if you compare that situation in Greece there with the Argentinian crisis of the early 2000s, I think the drop was quite similar, or by and large similar, but Argentina recovered much more quickly than Greece. Greece, as you see here, didn't really properly recover. But even if you look at a country like Italy, Italy still was at the onset of the COVID crisis, had a GDP level which was below that of 2008. So in that crisis 10 years ago, the recovery was much, much smaller, longer, and the economy didn't recover too quickly. So what are the reasons? Of course, one reason which comes to mind is a changed global macroeconomic environment. It's not only spreads that matter, but of course, it is the level of the interest rate, because the level of the interest rate show you in how far certain debt to GDP ratio is, given a certain growth rate, is actually sustainable. I mean, if you grow by 1.5 percentage points, 1% per year, if I have a real GDP growth rate of 1.5% per year, maybe 1.5% inflation, then you can actually at an interest rate as Italy is having it at the moment, which you see there is roughly 1% on long-term bonds, you can have quite large debt levels without any problems. I mean, in fact, despite these very high debt levels in the euro area, most countries pay a much lower share of their budget or their GDP in interest than they have in the past decades. I mean, Germany at the moment, with a debt to GDP ratio of 70-80%, we pay about 0.5% of GDP in interest each year. And that was about 6 or 7 times as much in the early 1990s. So the point is that with these government bond yields, of course, debt, much higher debt level is sustainable. And Olivier Blanchard made the calculations in early 2020 that, the Italian debt level, or for Italy, with the growth he was seeing, a debt level of 150% of GDP, public debt level, is completely sustainable. However, I think that's only part of the story, because we have things like self-fulfilling fiscal crisis. And for that, the euro area institutions, or the changes in euro area institutions and the policy reactions play an important role. And to understand that, we need to go back and first look at the origins of the 2010-2012 euro area crisis. Of course, excessive deficits have played a role. If Greece hadn't had a deficit of more than 10% of GDP, probably in 2010, they could have financed the deficit relatively easily, and there wouldn't have been this problem. So I don't go much into detail on these deficits, but you need to be aware that this is only a problem for some of the countries. Italy or Spain, they didn't have very high deficits, at least not in 2007-2008. The banking crisis then changed a bit of that, but there we need to look a bit more into the problems in the banking sector, which I will do a bit more in detail. I will discuss the doom loop between sovereigns and banks. That means that we had the problem that there was the expectations that banks needed to be saved, and that by itself led to a flight led to problems in the banking sector. I'll talk about self-fulfilling market panics. I'm sure you probably are familiar with that theory. One reason was boom-bust cycles in the periphery. I won't discuss that much because it doesn't play a role in the COVID crisis. But a structural divergence of competitiveness, a bit like Argentina had under the currency board prior to the crisis of 2000. And we had in Europe the specific situation of a loss of legitimacy because of dismal economic performance and a very toxic interaction of the political economy and financial markets. Let me go through some of those a bit more in detail. As I said, the excessive deficits are so obvious, I don't need to discuss them. But the problems in the banking sector have been a bit more subtle. We had the problem in Europe that we had in some countries lax regulation and excessive credit growth. And that led to problems in a number of countries. So we first had problems in the US subprime crisis, because in some countries, the banks were involved quite a bit in the US subprime market. So the big bank which failed in Germany, Lippo Real Estate, in 2008, 2009, they had just, I mean, it was a bank which was initially, the idea was that they work on financing German small and medium-sized companies, but they were involved they had bought US subprime papers. There was also, and I'll discuss that a bit later, a very toxic interaction between Ireland and Germany. Ireland had a specific banking regulation where it had two sets of banking regulations, basically. One was for banks which do business in Ireland, and one was for banks which have their headquarters in Ireland, but don't do business in Ireland. But because of European regulations, they could sell their products and do business with all other banks in Europe. And the second part, the second type of banks was very lightly regulated. And so German banks started to put subsidiaries into Dublin, well, which didn't do business in Ireland, but which engaged in very risky business all over the world. And when these banks failed, it ended up in the balance sheet of the German German banks and created problems here. So we had really a problem with the European regulation there. And during the euro crisis, well, of course, I mean, Greece, the economy basically collapsed. So there wasn't much the banks could do. Spain had lent too much in construction, and Cyprus had a very specific business model. So they also had an under-regulation of the banks and had problems there. Why am I telling you all this? Because basically this was initially pushed up the debt to GDP ratios, because all these countries I talked about, they somehow felt compelled to rescue their banks. And so that cost a lot of money, and that pushed up the debt to GDP ratios. Just to give you a comparison in historical terms, during the crisis of 2008, 2009, the German public debt level increased as much as during German reunification. You know, German reunification, we took the communist East, it was integrated in the German state. There were huge expenses, but well, this crisis was about as expensive, just the banking crisis there, 2008, 2009, as German reunification. Okay, so what was the specific problem? Well, in Europe, we have the situation that there is a home bias in banks. So the banks hold a lot of sovereign debt, and they tend to buy sovereign debt of their own country. So Deutsche Bank tends to have a lot of German debt, a little Italian, little French debt, but mostly German debt. Italian banks tend to have Italian debt, and French banks tend to have French debt. So what is the problem here? So if banks now have if there is the feeling that banks have a problem, then the fear is that the government has to inject a lot of money and needs to borrow. And if this is, if then there are doubts about the debt sustainability in that country, it means the bond prices fall and the interest rates rise. And that poses problems for the banks, for their balance sheets, because they have these bonds which have just fallen in value. And in a way, this becomes self-fulfilling, and it becomes a doom loop between sovereigns and banks. And this is something we have seen in the euro crisis, which we have tried to solve later on, but which frankly is still, this problem is not solved. Actually, the banks now have a higher share of domestic government bonds than they used to have prior to the crisis. Then there is another issue why monetary integration makes the problems in banking sectors worse, because we had the situation that banks could act in the European market. So if they were allowed to operate in one market, they could do it in all markets. But of course, as the case of Ireland, I've just told you, there are some external effects of insufficient oversight, and they are not taken, or they were not taken into account. And the second point is that financial market integration leads to bigger banks, at least relative to GDP. There's a Krugman argument. If you form a currency union, you have concentration of certain industries in certain countries. So the car industry is now concentrated in Germany because of agglomeration effects and spillovers, and banks are concentrated in other countries like Luxembourg or maybe Belgium. And for smaller countries, it means you have a much larger market than before. I mean, a country like Belgium, with maybe 10 million people living there, a bit more than that, they just cannot have very large banks if they are limited to their domestic markets. However, if they can operate in the European Union of 300 million people, they can get very large. They can quickly be so large that they are just too big to save. So government cannot practically save them. And that creates then problems in a monetary union. So crisis cause number four were self-fulfilling markets panics. This is quite well understood since the Mexican crisis, I would say, that this is possible. And the model is one of multiple equilibria. Basically, the argument is there are certain debt levels which are clearly unsustainable, then you will have sooner or later find yourself in a crisis. And there's some debt levels which are clearly sustainable. But in between, it just depends what the investors believe. If the investors believe you're solvent, then they don't demand higher interest rates and you remain solvent. But if they doubt your solvency, then the interest rates increase, and just that puts you into insolvency. And I mean, the example is just imagine you have a mortgage on your house, and you pay 5% interest rates. Maybe that's 500 euros a month. And now the bank believes that, well, for some reason, someone has defaulted in your neighborhood, and they say, well, maybe that you are risky as well. And in order to cover that risk, I increase your interest rate to 20%. And suddenly you have to pay 2,000 euros in mortgage, and that might just be too much for your income. And the same mechanism might be at work for government debt. And by the way, this is something which at least partly played a role both in the Argentinian crisis, but also in the Brazilian crisis. I mean, in both of these cases, you could have argued there wasn't underlying vulnerability, but of course it was the interest rate increase which pushed the country well over the brink or close to the brink. And from that literature, we know what can help. If you have a lender of last resort, you can solve this problem. So basically, if you have your own central bank, which can print your own money, and your debt is in your own money, then that's not a problem because you can always print your money. And because investors know that you can do so, that there won't be this negative equilibrium. However, as Argentina learned in the 2000s, if you borrow in a currency which you cannot print, then that is a problem. And actually, the euro area, European Monetary Union, in its original form, which we had in the 2010s, had introduced this original sin, as this is called in the literature, through the back door. Because in the Maastricht Treaty, we put a provision which says the European Central Bank is not allowed to lend to governments. Yeah, and of course, if you don't do that, then you are subject to this kind of problem. Okay, then finally, there was an interaction the political economy and the crisis, the financial markets. And this basically worked in the following way. We had a number of countries where populists gained who had said, well, let's rethink the membership of the euro. And of course, whenever they gained in the polls, people became nervous and they started, for example, to move their money abroad. That's what we have seen in Greece when Syriza gained in the polls. People and they said, well, we think leaving the euro, and the people moved their money from the banks abroad, and the banks had liquidity problems because of the funds being moved out. And actually people then moved their funds from out of bonds. So the bond prices fell and you had this increase in interest rates. So this is a problem where you don't have a proper tool because, I mean, as the other countries, you cannot say, well, no matter what your politicians do, we guarantee the deposits in euro. I mean, even if your politicians say we leave the euro and we redenominate all debts, well, we don't worry, we repay the deficits. But you also cannot say that you don't do it, because if you don't do it, I mean, if you do it, you create an incentive for the populace actually leaving. And if you don't do it, you create an incentive for the savers to move their money abroad. So that is a danger with which Europe was also at that point confronted. And what you see here is Italian bond spreads or Italian yields. It's not bond spreads, but they are pretty similar during that time. Well, the movement is pretty similar. And what you see in 2018 here, the spike, that is when the government, the newly elected government of the Five Star Movement, well, there was a government formed from right-wing populists and left-wing populists in 2018, and they had a conflict with the European Commission about keeping their promises of austerity. And this conflict alone here created this spike in government yields. And the point was that the Five Star Movement actually had said that they wanted to leave the euro, and there was a paper circulated, so-called Plan B, how Italy could leave the euro. And of course, this was all in the end. It was solved, and they backpedaled, and they said, well, we do what the European Commission demands. But still, you see here the mechanism and the potential danger of it. Okay, by the way, I think the euro crisis could have been dealt with much more swiftly and much better if the euro countries had taken on board the lessons from Latin America. In fact, the IMF was much further. I mean, the IMF was involved in these programs as a junior partner, or junior partner in terms of money, supposedly senior partner in terms of program development. And the IMF should have known and did know, which we show from documents of the IMF, that what they did in Europe wasn't a very good crisis approach. Because what they did is basically, they saw that Greece was in a position where at least at the interest rates which we had in financial markets at that time, Greece was at a position where it's probably the debt was not sustainable. Yet the IMF, despite, I mean, if you know debt is not sustainable, it doesn't make sense to postpone a debt restructuring. Yeah, because then what you do is you lend more, and in the end you have to default anyway. So it doesn't do any good. And basically the IMF should have known and knew that after the crisis in Argentina and Brazil in the early 2000s, that only if it's a liquidity crisis, loan provisions make sense. And if you do it, you need to promise very large loans. The loan for Brazil in 2002 was the largest then in the history of the IMF at that point, and it did work. But in the case of Greece, the IMF knew the debt was not sustainable, but they lent nevertheless, and they lent an amount of money which didn't last half a year. So it was clear to see that the 100 billion they put on the table wouldn't last, and it was gone pretty quickly. So basically, towards the end of the year, they had to construct a debt relief anyway. And because at that point, the IMF and the EU had lent so much money, you couldn't properly restructure, because the IMF and the EU always want their money back. So even the restructuring you did then was insufficient. So the IMF here did not manage to translate the experiences from Latin American crisis to the euro area. So what has happened in the euro area since then until now? And it's always very difficult to understand that. I mean, anyway from outside of the euro area, but these reforms have been so complicated and the institutions so opaque by now that even if you talk to national parliamentarians, even people in the finance ministry, they don't understand perfectly all the rules which are now in place. We have now, let me just put the basic bullet points here. The so-called six-pack and two-pack were passed, which limits deficits and debt. So now in times outside of crisis, in principle, European countries are only allowed to run deficits of 0.5% of GDP in structural terms. If debt falls below 60% of GDP, this can go up to 1% of GDP. But if you look around in the world, this is relatively strict. We have preventive and corrective arms now. So the budgets need to be reported to Brussels in September. And then there's a consultation process. There are procedures which in the end could impose fines on the membership, on the countries which are members of the Eurozone. And it's really, it's quite difficult. There's a document which outlines these procedures, and it is a bit more than 100 pages long, just to explain, to give you a picture of how this is done. Then a fiscal compact, so-called fiscal compact, was signed. That was a multilateral treaty of most of the Euro countries, or EU countries even, which basically underlined the principles of the six-pack and two-pack, again, limiting deficits and debt. Here's also the rule. I forgot that the six-pack, the two-pack says, if your debt is above 60% of GDP, you need to reduce it by 1/20th of the difference to the 60% each year. So in principle, according to these rules, if it is ever applied again, Italy at the moment at 150% debt to GDP ratio would have to reduce, the difference to 60% is 90, 1/20th of that is 4.5 percentage points of GDP each year. Then we had the ESM and the OMT, and the ESM is, I'll discuss that a bit more in detail. ESM is a big fund, a volume of 750 billion, where member countries can borrow from, and OMT stands for outright monetary transactions. And this is a tool by the European Central Bank, where the European Central Bank now is allowed to buy bonds of membership countries for market stabilization. And there's a banking union. I discussed a little bit the problems of national regulation in a transnational financial market. Banking union is now supposed to put the regulation on a European level, and also has some European bailout mechanisms to break the doom loop, but it's not completed yet. Let me say a few words on these, on the two main tools, the ESM and the OMT. The ESM is a facility with a volume up to 750 billion euros. It borrows in financial markets, it's guaranteed by the euro area member states, and it then lends the money to member states in troubles. So in principle, you can say it's a little bit like the IMF, but at lower interest rates. They just pass on the financing costs, and the euro countries can finance quite cheaply. So Greece pays for the ESM loans, it has about 1% of 1% interest, nominal interest rates per year, and Cyprus 0.8%. So, I mean, if I look at Argentina, these are quite competitive interest rates. OMT is outright monetary transactions. And that's basically the way how Mario Draghi put into operation his famous words. You might remember in July 2012, at the heights of the euro crisis, when the ESM hadn't helped anymore and the yields were still very high, Mario Draghi gave a speech in London and to financial markets participants, and he said that the European Central Bank would do whatever it takes to save the euro. And he said, then believe me, it will be enough. And OMT is basically the manifestation of this promise. And under this new instrument, the ECB can buy short-term bonds of countries in dire straits in secondary market without regard of its capital key. What does that mean? Normally, if the ECB does monetary policy operations, it needs to buy the bonds by the member states according to the capital key. Capital key is which which members have which kind of equity stake in the ECB, and that is linked to GDP and population. But of course, if you want to quell a financial market panic where, let's say, Italian yields go up, you don't want to buy German bonds as well in proportion to Italian bonds, but you only want to buy Italian bonds, and the OMT is actually allowing the ECB to do that. Okay, let me just check, and in order to see what has happened since the crisis of 2010, I prepared this table. And on the horizontal axis, you have the different packages which were passed, and vertically you have the problems which have led to the crisis. And I will just tick off where problems have been addressed. So here the problems. The excessive deficits have been addressed by six-pack, two-pack, and the fiscal compact, so basically three times. The self-fulfilling fiscal crisis has been addressed by both the lending capacities of the ESM, because it can act as a lender of last resort to governments, and plus the ECB, because the ESM lending is limited, even to a large share, and but the ECB is not. So this together covers this quite well, but we have unresolved problems in the banking sector, and we have unresolved doom loop between bank and sovereigns. So also the boom and bust cycles and the diverging competitiveness has not been solved, or at least only partly been solved with some of the rules. And we still have the loss of legitimacy because of the dismal growth performance, which has led to the populace being strengthened. The fact that so many problems were unresolved led to this cartoon, basically, where you see Angela Merkel, François Hollande, so the German heads of state and governments having taped together the euro, and then, Cyprus is playing soccer, and you know what would happen if this is hit by a soccer ball. Okay, what also was different? The EU policy reactions to the COVID crisis were completely different than before. First, the EU Commission with the member states, they created a large support facility for member states right away, already in the spring of 2020. The first package was the SURE package, that is support to mitigate unemployment risks in emergency, which gives up to 100 billion euros in subsidized loans to countries. And then we had something which looks like a common fiscal policy, or the first time we had something like a common fiscal policy for the EU, and that was the next generation EU program, or the Recovery and Resilience Facility. And here, for the first time, if you don't look at the ESM, but that's a different thing, but here, for the first time, the European Union's issued common debt in a reasonable quantity. The European Union borrowed 750 billion and distributed those in grants and loans to the member states. And differently from the ESM, this is really money which is spent. It's not just liquidity, but it has a fiscal impact. And especially these 390 billion in grants have quite some relevance, especially because the distribution was tilted towards most hit countries. And that is really something new and potentially game-changing. And what I show you here is some of our calculations. You see the share, how big these grants are as a share of 2019 GDP. And you see for countries like Germany, that is far on the right, this is quite insignificant. That is only, this is not 0.1% of GDP or something like that per year. And overall, also quite maybe 0.5% of GDP or a bit more. But if you look at countries like interesting, Bulgaria, almost 10%, Greece, 8%, more than 8% of GDP, Portugal, 6% of GDP, even Spain, a relatively large country, gets almost 5% of GDP out of that fund. This also has a macroeconomic impact. What we did here is we simulated with the Niger multi-country model what the impact on GDP is, and put that in relation to the drop in GDP through the COVID crisis. And you see, for example, Spain and Italy, they have seen their GDP level drop by 10-12%, and almost 5%, 4-5% of that job were just made up by these new funds and the money spent. This goes mostly into public investment, so there is really a significant boost to the economy. Okay, and the ECB reacted much more strongly. In the first crisis, it took them until 2012 before they started really buying bonds at a large scale. And here, quite early in the pandemic, the ECB enacted the so-called Pandemic Emergency Purchase Program. It had an initial volume of 50 billion, and then they passed a second envelope of 600 additional billion in June, another 600 billion in December, and also they allowed to apply the capital key flexibly, as it is called, so they can also buy Italian bonds and not German bonds. So in comparison to 2010, this was a much, much swifter reaction, and I think it explains why the yields have remained low. And here, the ECB has really taken on its role of lender of last resort in the pandemic, not just stating it. Under OMT, not much was bought, but here there were actually quite significant volumes of bonds were actually bought in this crisis. Okay, so basically, the ECB program strengthens the fight against self-fulfilling fiscal crisis. And this large NextGen EU program, because it creates growth which is sizable and can be felt in the member states, this is something which attacks this loss of legitimacy. So my conclusions, and I'm sorry, I think I took a bit more time than I was supposed to. My conclusion, the euro crisis has weathered the COVID crisis much better than the euro crisis, and the three factors have been benign interest rate environment, past institutional changes, but also swift and decisive policy reaction, both a common fiscal policy, but also a much more decisive reaction by the European Central Bank. And so basically the ECB took the original sin problems off the table again and saved the day again. Okay, and there are three contributions on which parts of this presentation have been based. And as I said, I'm trying to write something up and then we will upload it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sebastian, for your very nice presentation. We will now move to the discussion. We may start with Emi Vasco, if you want, Emi.
Well, this is some comments regarding the presentation that Sebastian has already presented. Well, let's start with the beginning. Well, the outline is what does the presentation of Sebastian do? The main findings of his presentation, my comments and some final remarks. Well, Sebastian's main question was, why didn't we see a replay of the 2010 and 2012 crisis in some European countries? And the answer, apart from benign interest rates, low levels, the euro area institution and policy reaction play a key role. What the presentation does, Sebastian compares the macroeconomic condition between the two crises. It reviews the origin of the 2010 and 2012 crisis. It also reviews the institutional reforms in the EU since 2010. And finally, the presentation analyzes the EU and ECB reactions in the COVID-19 crisis. The main findings of the presentation was that there were kind of similar macroeconomic conditions between both crises in terms of, especially in terms of deficits and debt levels, except for Greece, deficits were as high as in 2020 as in 2010. Debt to GDP ratios were higher in 2020 than in 2010. However, bond spreads did hardly react in the 2020 and 2021 COVID crisis. The second main finding is that institutional reforms in the EU since 2010 have been a key factor to weather the COVID crisis better. Excessive deficits and self-fulfilling fiscal crisis mentioned were completely taken, according to the presentation, by euro area reforms. On the contrary, problems in banking sector, doom loop between banks and sovereigns, boom bust cycles and diverging competitiveness were unresolved or partially resolved. Finally, the loss of legitimacy because of dismal performance was completely addressed. The other key factor was a swift and decisive policy reaction by the EU and the ECB in the COVID-19 crisis. First, fiscal policy. The EU Commission created large support facility for member states. Regarding, for example, the first one was the SURE, supporting to mitigate unemployment risk and emergency. And the second one, the new one, Next Generation EU or RRF, recovery and resilient facilities. Regarding the monetary policy or regarding the ECB, the reaction was decisive. The pandemic emerging purchase program, in comparison to the to 2010 and 2012, there was much swifter reaction, and the ECB has really taken on its role of lender of first resort in the pandemic. My comments. This time, I think it was different in Europe. I agree on that, especially for PIGS, but why? The initial macro conditions and the nature of the crisis were completely different. You point some, the presentation pointed some differences, but it's a key factor. Then the institutional reforms didn't seem to play a key role during the worst of the pandemic. And finally, the decisive policy response, I agree. The ECB, whatever it takes, was a paradigm change. But what was novel was the complementary role between the ECB monetary policy and each EU member's countercyclical fiscal policy, not especially the common fiscal EU common policy. So regarding the macro conditions and the nature of the crisis, in the global financial crisis, the euro area was at the epicenter of the crisis, banking crisis, doubts about the fiscal solvency, large deficit in current account. Italy, Spain, and Portugal faced at the start of the pandemic current account surpluses, and they have followed a path of improving their competitiveness environment. COVID-19 was a global transitory exogenous shock, so the nature was different. As vaccination campaigns progressed and restrictions started to be lifted, the world economy rebounded. So this is regarding my first comment. The second one, the institutional reforms that don't seem to play a relevant role. Only two of the problems mentioned were completely tackled by area reforms. The fiscal compact was supposed to tackle excessive deficits. Nevertheless, they were large in many countries at the start of the pandemic. The second, the self-fulfilling crisis, was dealt with the ECB policies. That's okay. Regarding the rest of the problem, such as banking sector issues, doom loop, etc., that you already mentioned, were unresolved or partially resolved. And finally, the loss of legitimacy because of dismal growth performance was completely addressed. The third one is the decisive policy response was a key factor. I agree on that. But what I want to mention is that support facilities created by the EU Commission were small compared to the EU members' own fiscal policies. Sure, was below 0.75% of the euro GDP, small amount compared to every domestic package. The next Gen EU program could be a game changer in the future because most of its budget will be disbursed in coming years. So it hasn't played a key role during the worst of the pandemic. The next could be, but could be in the future. National policies have provided critical support for workers and firms. Alongside large automatic stabilizer, the discretionary fiscal response has been both rapid and sizable, with above all the line measures, there is estimation about 5% of euro area GDP. And regarding the monetary policy, the ECB calibrated its monetary policy to avoid market fragmentation and ensure the effective transmission to a single monetary policy to the entire euro area. The most important measures were the PEP, which is buying private and public sector assets, and the giving lending, favorable lending conditions to banks, meeting a predefined lending threshold. So the spread of the euro area weighted sovereign yields over risk-free assets declined after the announcement of the PEP was very clear. So that's something that you mentioned in your presentation. So I found the presentation on avoiding the euro area crisis very inspiring and useful for taking lesson for the economy in our region. It integrated all the topics very easily. Some suggestions: add more variables and vulnerability indicators to the macro situation comparison. This crisis was markedly different in the origin and the initial macro conditions. Maybe identify the different group of countries affected by policy and reforms. Euro area subgroups, etc. Compare the different packages and measures in terms of GDP of each EU member. Then you can also classify the final use of next gen EU by country. In the future, it could be a game changer, and it would be interesting to monitor the pace if it is dispersed and the areas that it might try to tackle. For example, green change, digital change, social cohesion, education, etc. It would be very interesting the role it's going to have. And finally, to check robustness, it would be interesting to analyze policies or macro results with other country group. For example, not EU countries or Latin American countries, and comparing the recoveries and its policy from the crisis. Thank you very much, Sebastian, and I hope this could be useful.
Gracias, Emi. Antes de pasar a la siguiente, al siguiente comentario, si recuerden que si tienen preguntas, pueden hacerlas por el chat. Si no se sienten cómodos con el inglés, pueden hacerlas en castellano y nosotros los ayudamos con la traducción. Horacio.
Thank you, Ariel, and thanks, Sebastian, for a very insightful presentation. So here are my comments, and which are to a certain extent collinear with those that Emiliano just made, which is a good thing since we had not discussed this beforehand. It's good to know someone else is reading a similar thing. This is a summary of what Sebastian just told us, but I think Emiliano did a very good job, I think, of summarizing this. Sebastian finds that this time was different compared to the Euro 2010-2012 crisis, and institutional changes played a very important role, lower interest rate, the decisive policy action, common fiscal policy, and very importantly, the reaction of the ECB. I think there are a few critical points that one should go through, and this has to do to the shock that the EU and the world went through, what was the ways in which the shock was transmitted, and very importantly, the international dimension of the shock and of the policy response. I think the policy response touched at least on the transmission mechanism and the international dimension in a very, very important way, and one should think about the policy response as part of this system. So as for the shock, and I think Emiliano already pointed this out clearly, this was a very, very different shock from COVID-19. So we're talking very different things here. The euro crisis, the financial system was at the heart of the euro crisis. To my mind, the euro crisis can be thought of as an aftermath of the global financial crisis, and I don't think it would have occurred without it. So it was just like a later manifestation of the GFC, whereas the COVID was a health shock, and then we saw the financial consequences. We saw the dust for cash, especially March and April 2020, which was pretty dramatic, but short-lived. due to the reasons, some of the reasons that Sebastian pointed out. But all in all, if you have to think what was going on in the economy, I think the what we saw in the euro area 2010-12 crisis was the kind the typical problem of a currency union where an asymmetric shock hits, and then some of their members had better have a floating interest rate to adjust, but they don't. So they suffered the pain from the peg, right? It's a painful process for them because some prices that could adjust, they just not adjust, and they suffer a lot. This peg and pain phrase is borrowed from a very nice model by Schmidt and Uribe on the Euro crisis in 2012. Whereas the current crisis was a common shock, right? So this is a common shock for Europe and for the world. What was going on in the economy was a completely different thing. And actually, this was a shock, really, because I think we talk about shocks in economics, which are not really shocks. I mean, this is very convenient from all the modeling and empirical literature, but sometimes it's very hard to find these pure shocks in the economy. But really, the COVID crisis was a true shock, if there ever was one. And it was a total factor productivity shock, because all of a sudden no one could go to their jobs. I mean, you had exactly the same working population, you had exactly the same capital, you had exactly the same technology, but then you couldn't use them overnight. So of course, then it was a demand shock as well, but this is really what I think was at play there, and which makes a huge difference in terms of how the economy will react to it, compared to, for instance, a core versus periphery shock, which is what you have, I think, in the case of the Euro era 2012 crisis, as I think Sebastian already very, very aptly described. So was this really a debt crisis? I find it hard to think the current crisis is a debt crisis, at least at the moment, at least in 2020, which is when a lot of the measures that Sebastian described were taken. We know, of course, that the GFC and the Euro crisis were debt crisis, but it was not a crisis. Of course, debt mounted as a result of the policy response to the crisis, but debt was not at the heart of the crisis. It may prove to be this way if problems worsen, you know, with the news that we've had in these days, we may see several further waves of the virus ahead, and we may get into further trouble. But I think the current crisis looks a lot more like a purely, at least in 2020, as a pure liquidity crisis versus a solvency crisis and a balance of payment crisis and a peg, a painful peg crisis like the 2010. In this respect, how the crisis transmitted, I think liquidity plays a key role here, the absence of liquidity and the provision of liquidity. I mean, when we're standing in 2020, we all tend to, or I think the idea this was a temporary shock. Now, if this is a temporary shock, this is exactly the situation in which providing liquidity makes sense, because, I mean, the economy, productive capacity is there, so you just need the short-term resources that are not there. Like I said, standing in 2020, we may tell a somewhat different story today. Standing in 2020, that was what policymakers could think. So in that respect, I think ECB action is key, just as Sebastian said. And the monetary policy strategy review, that is an institutional reform of sorts, if you ask me, perhaps an ex post reform, and which actually puts in black and white what the ECB was already doing. But I think it's this is what this I think was really very important at the European domestic level. And just as Emiliano said, what's the role for the next generation and for the fiscal package? This is potentially very large, and I underscore potentially, just as Sebastian did. But I don't know if those 750 billion euros, how much have we already seen in terms of resources that have already been spent? I don't really know, but my suspicion is that not so much. So we still haven't seen if been as effective. My prior worry that it will be really very effective, as the simulations that Sebastian showed us, but still, perhaps it did not still play such an important role. The same applies to consolidated supervision, which is a perfectly an excellent idea. But I wonder if it played any role in the response to the 2020 crisis. So generally, and I share this with Emiliano, I think the certain reforms may be overplayed in Sebastian's assessment of what, which are, I mean, they're perfectly welcome. They are super necessary for a currency union, but I don't know if we've seen them actually playing a role as Sebastian claims. Now, there is also the international dimension, which I think merits a good look. Sebastian said that there is the question of original sin, which is the question of needing funds in a currency that you do not issue. Now, the whole global economy suffers from that problem, which many people now call dominant currency funding, right? Most of funding, international financial markets take place in US dollar, but only one country in the world issues US dollars. And this was really an issue in the 2010 dash for cash in March and April 2020, where asset managers suddenly sold all their positions and just wanted the liquidity, but only the Fed could provide the liquidity. And the Fed ultimately provided that liquidity. Aldazoro, Ehlers, Maguire, and Peter from the BIS have shown that the shortage of USD funding in interbank markets roughly matches the excess, the supply of USD funding by the Fed through its swap lines. So my point with the game changer was the decisive Fed action there, because this was a global crisis and where liquidity is demanded in a currency that only the Fed can issue. And in this sense, I think the ECB should be seen as part of this system of provision of global liquidity. Of course, the ECB is also a reserve currency, so provision of euro liquidity is also very important at the global level. And what we see in this chart is that it ultimately, the ECB also played a role there. Here on the right-hand side, you see the maximum agreed amounts, and for the Fed it was 450 billion. And actually the total, the highest use of the ECB, the Fed line was 450 billion around April or May last year, which was basically what was supplied by the Fed. But the ECB was also there. And this was definitely, this was very important. But once again, I think you have to see these central banks working as a system here and not by themselves. And this is to, and very importantly, and Sebastian pointed the issue of the Argentine crisis and the Brazilian crisis. These banks were providing liquidity to countries. Not only they were providing liquidity to countries in advanced, to advanced economies, but they were always providing liquidity to countries, let's call it in the periphery or into developing countries, in the order of 60 or 30 billion in the case of the Fed. So this was very, very significant. And to underscore the point of the Fed being the game changer here, well, the panel on the left shows that the highest usage of the Fed liquidity swaps, which, like I mentioned, was in the order of 450 billion, whereas in the case of the ECB, it was, well, it basically did not happen last year. The most important uses were this year and relatively, like in July, in the order of 3 billion euros, which, of course, it can be also very significant, depends on the country and everything, but at a global systemic level, I think the real game changer was the Fed. So all in all, was the shock different? Was the transmission mechanism different? Was international dimension different? The shock, for all the reasons I mentioned, I think was very, very different. The way it transmitted through the Euros, the EU economies was very different as well. Or was somewhat different, right? Because of course balance sheets are involved, of course liquidity is involved, but of course I think solvency and FX mismatches were much more heavily involved during the euro area crisis. And the international dimension was somewhat similar, because in both cases you had a FX swap network which provided liquidity, massive liquidity. So there is some similarity there. So how to think of this looking ahead, I think the policy reaction that very neatly Sebastian described should be seen as part of the system in the way which I was just describing. And it's necessary, I think, to pinpoint the specific role of monetary policy, fiscal policy, and institutional reforms and their contribution compared to other measures. So we have to look at fiscal policy and how much has been spent and how has it impacted in the EU economy. We have to look at supervision. I don't know, perhaps consolidated supervision has played a role, but you need granular data there, which in some European countries you have, and so it will be worth looking at it. The monetary policy strategy, I think we all agree that's been really a very important determinant, and Sebastian recognizes this also. So I think we're there. And then the problems that we have looking ahead is that this liquidity crisis turns, or what was a liquidity crisis, if the crisis was averted, turns into a solvency problem as we go along. And I think there are already signs out there of this. The risk of a divergent recovery and how the EU will deal with this, and vaccination, which underpins the problem of the divergent recovery, especially in the face of new variants of the virus. And then financial volatility, and something I did not mention, but I think was not only me, I mean, which was also a key issue in last year's financial turmoil, which is the role of non-bank financial intermediaries. This is very neatly described in an FS Financial Stability Board report, which shows very clearly the role of non-bank financial intermediaries, basically funds, asset managers, in actually producing the liquidity shock last year and propagating it. So looking forward, I think this is a kind of factor that we will have to pay much more attention to. And I think at least the Bank of England and the Bank of Italy have already done work on this. So I think we'll see more there. So thank you, and congratulations on the paper.
Thank you very much, Emiliano, Horacio. Perhaps Sebastian, you can react to the comments if you want before we pass to the Q&A session.
Yeah, well, thank you very much for the very insightful comments and the careful reading. I think on one thing, I wasn't quite clear what I meant. I completely agree with you that the fiscal rules and the common supervision didn't play a role for this resilience. I mean, the fiscal rules, they solved a problem which wasn't a problem of this crisis. I completely agree with what you said. I think key were basically, from the institutional reforms, what was played a role now was the ESM-OMT setup in my eyes, because it had stabilized the expectations from the very beginning, but then that the ECB put on that the pandemic purchase program, the emergency purchase program. So that combination was the main stabilizing issue. On the banks, I think common supervision wasn't as important as the common rules for better equity capital. Yeah, so better capital buffers, which helped. But of course, alone that would not have saved the day if you didn't have the national fiscal reactions. On NextGen EU, I think it played a bigger role than what you say now, because if you look at the national budgets, they have already planned last year. As soon as that was agreed, they planned with the money coming in. So basically, NextGen EU, pretty much like the SURE program, that helped the nation states to let their automatic stabilizers play and to prevent cuts in public expenditure, which they otherwise would have, well, we never know what would have happened, but where I think it's a legitimate case to say they would have changed, they would have cut. And I mean, you see that in the German budget, where you would say Germany doesn't have a problem of borrowing more. They have taken this money into the German budget and made it part of that, even though before some additional investments are now planned and enacted, because that would take a longer time. And I think therefore it also had, with the way how it was communicated, it had a stabilizing effect, because it prevented anti-European or anti-EU feelings and prevented that. I mean, we haven't seen, despite some problems with border closures and medical equipment not being delivered in other countries at the beginning of the crisis, we have not seen a resurgence of populist votes here. We have even seen an increase in the support of the European Union. And I think that that was a stabilizing issue. But I mean, you're completely right. I should have made that clearer, which institutional changes have played a role for this crisis, because this crisis was different. I'm not 100% sure, Urashi, whether I would agree with your characterization how it was different, because also I'm not sure whether, I mean, if your argument is true that the great financial crisis caused the euro crisis, where I have a lot of sympathy for, then that was not an asymmetric crisis, but from the origin a symmetric crisis, common crisis, and the COVID crisis wasn't that common and symmetric either. If you look at Italy was much harder hit at the beginning and still in the whole of 2020 than Germany, for example. So again, it's not, I think your points are valid, but I'm not sure I would go as far as you have gone there. Thanks also for pointing out the Fed reaction. I mean, usually I used to look a lot at international markets, but I have to admit that in the past 18 months, I have looked mostly at European issues. With travel restricted, but I have to really say that my horizon has narrowed over that time. Although that was very valuable that you have pointed that out. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. I think Pedro has a question.
Okay, yes, thank you, Ariel. Thank you, Sebastian, excellent presentation, nice work. And really good comments as well. I just want to ask you to think a little bit more on this fiscal policy and the risk sharing mechanism as comparing with a federal country like US or something like that. I mean, like Argentina or Brazil, same shock in a federal country. There are some fiscal mechanisms to share the risk and share the impact. But that also may generate some incentive problems. So when we look at different countries, the results are not the same that in the same country. So my question is, what happened with the peripheral countries in that set?
Do you want me to answer right away?
Let me ask the audience if there are further questions. Otherwise, we can proceed. ¿Hay otras preguntas?
Sí, Ariel.
Okay. Sebastián.
Sí. Okay, well, many thanks, Sebastian, for a very nice presentation, and Horacio and Emiliano for very interesting and challenging comments. I have two questions or two issues to ask you, Sebastian. The one is, when you say, and it is interesting to the metric, the idea that after the global financial crisis, there was a slower recovery of the economy, and you attribute that to, well, the lack of institutional reforms, etc. One can agree with that, but I was thinking that probably it is important to control, for one thing, because I think the shock, it was a different shock. In the case of the pre-global financial crisis trend, probably there are some possibility that part of that trend was not sustainable, okay? And in that sense, I think that if you don't think that it is necessary to control for the a non-sustainable part of the pre-global financial crisis trend, if there is some unsustainability there, to measure the recovery, because probably the trend after the global financial crisis doesn't need to be exactly the same. And in this case, we had a different kind of shock, probably with aftershocks effects, but I think that it is important to control, to say what was a more effective situation. And the other very, very short comment has to be with, I remember when you were talking about, I was remembering one important paper by Charles Goodhart that was written in 1998, when he was discussing two concepts of money and the idea that one of the failures, if institutional failures of the effects of the design of the European Union was related with the issue that you had, I would say, an international money, but national fiscal policies. And in a way, I think that the point you made about the 2012 decision on speech by Draghi, the Euro moment of Draghi, whatever it takes, it is very important because right now it is there, and that dispels a lot of doubts about what is going to happen after that decision was taken. Many thanks.
Thanks, Sebastian. Any further questions? Okay, Sebastian, Julien, you can answer.
Again, thanks for, these are two excellent questions. And again, it has shown me that I wasn't quite precise in what I said today, because you're completely right, Sebastian, that one should control first for the unsustainable part of the crisis. But I think I also didn't state why I think that the recovery was much slower. And in fact, some of the institution reforms I've shown you have not been positive, but rather negative on that recovery speed. And for example, these fiscal rules have led, at least that's what my institute thinks, and we have run simulations on that, have led to excessive austerity after that crisis. Yeah, because we have tried to bring down deficits much in a situation of output well below potential. The governments have together tried to bring down deficits in the Eurozone, which had negative spillover effects. So the whole Eurozone has grown quite slowly after 2012 for a while. And I think that is an important part of that story. But of course you are right. Despite that, there has been an unsustainable part of the crisis. I mean, the current account deficit of Greece probably was not sustainable to start with, also for Spain. But on the other hand, you had some countries which didn't have unsustainable fiscal deficits and were not doing well after that. I mean, Italy is a country. Italy had didn't have a current account deficit. Yeah, and still after the crisis, I mean, you can still say that maybe the debt level wasn't sustainable, but the deficits weren't really large either. So you have to explain that. And here, not all of these, I mean, the problem is with the table I've shown you, in a way I mixed institutions which were aimed to solve a problem and which really solved a problem together in that table. I mean, these triple fiscal rules were probably excessive and not necessary. Even they were addressing a certain problem. So this is a very good point. On Goodhart, the euro area started with having national fiscal policies plus having reintroduced original sin through the back door for most of the countries, in my eyes. Now they have moved, and especially, and you all pointed that out, what the ECB has done, and especially probably their change in thinking, and now it's a bit also reflected in the new strategy, that has made the euro more of a common currency than, I mean, it has turned the euro from a foreign currency to a common currency, I would say, for most of the member states. What we still don't have is a common fiscal policy, and at least one could say the Next Gen EU could be a starting point for that. And the way it has been done now, it has an insurance element, because the countries hit most by the crisis, they were given more. And Pedro, you're completely right with the question of incentives. I mean, that is something which is always discussed when we talk about insurance mechanisms in Europe. And I've worked a lot on European unemployment insurance and reinsurance proposals. And the argument you always get is, well, if you introduce that, there's a moral hazard problem of some of the countries. The reason why the NextGen EU went through politically, even in countries like Germany, which is a net payer to that scheme, is that in this specific case, you could clearly say there is no moral hazard issue. Yeah, the pandemic has hit. It has hit some countries worse than others. That was mostly bad luck, because Italy had the virus before us. So we could see what's happening in Italy, and we could close down the economy earlier. So we didn't hit us as badly. And in this specific case, well, ex post insurance, if something can be like that, yeah, it doesn't create moral hazard issues. So, but of course, that's a problem going forward, because we don't have a proper blueprint how you install something without the moral hazard issues. And usually federal countries have a deeper feeling of common destiny than the European countries have. And still, the Bavarian in Germany is more likely to be willing to pay someone from the north of Germany than for someone living in Greece. And again, that is an issue, but I guess Europe will have to do something in that respect, because it's still incomplete. We have now a common currency and national fiscal policies, and maybe we need to find something of more of a common fiscal policy as well.
Well, thank you, Sebastian. There are further questions from the audience. If not, we can conclude the seminar. Thank you, Sebastian, again for participating. Thank you very much. The comments by Emiliano and Horacio, they were quite insightful. Also the audience for participating. Well, we hope to have you again, Sebastian.
Yeah, I hope so as well.
Thank you very much, and bye-bye.
Thanks for the invitation and the organization and all the insightful comments. Bye-bye.